Good evening and happy Sabbath.
Good evening.
I am so happy that I am given this privilege to speak tonight. This will be the second, the last meeting that we have for this week of prayer. I'm happy that we have this kind of program here, preparing ourselves for the ministry in the future. Let's bow our heads. Father God, we would like to invite your presence through your Holy Spirit. Give us encouragement and inspiration, O God, as we study your words. May I pray for a special recognition, people. Open their hearts, O God, and open their minds for them to understand the purpose why you have called them and why you have prayed for them. Thank you for hearing our prayers and thank you for cleansing us from all our sins. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As I reflect on the responsibility on our shoulders as teachers of the College of Theology, I cannot help but to really ask myself, am I really doing my part as a teacher in molding you as future pastors? And I was thinking of this company of Mitsubishi or other car companies. They are the manufacturers, and their finished product are these cars, and the people are the users, the clients. And then on the same way, I'm thinking that we here at AUP, we are the manufacturers. Of course, that is not literal. But in a sense, we are the manufacturers of the product. And you are our product. And the church members are the recipients. Of course, cars carry people and brought anywhere else, but you are to carry people towards heaven. And so, I said to myself, is AUP, College of Theology, really preparing you to become future pastors? You know what? I fully believe. And I have talked to you and have mentioned this many times. You, as future pastors, you will take our place. And you will be maneuvering the direction of the church. Some of you will be elected as union president, probably the division, conference president, district pastors, department directors. And if we have not done our best here at AUP to really prepare you or manufacture you the way you should be, then we are missing the point. Remember the time when there was problem with Montero? Oh, people are afraid to buy Montero. Why? Because they just run, you know, without any cost, you turn it on, then it runs, you know, and accident happens. And so as I reflect on this, I thought of giving you some lessons from the Bible. And as I was reading, I am surprised that from the very beginning, nobody talked about Paul. And our theme is the road to Damascus. Because probably I said, because Paul is a very familiar story to all of us, and we knew very well what had happened to him. But Paul, you know, these things have something to do with his conversion and with his calling as a minister of God. I have looked at some of the references, and the name Paul came from the Greek Paulos, from Latin Paulos. Difference is only in the spelling. A Roman surname meaning little or small. He is introduced in the Bible as Saul, from Greek Saulos, from the Hebrew Saul, and it means asked of God or lent to God. And you know, as I was reading the life of Paul, of course, there was that school in Tarsus where he was educated. And later on, he went to Jerusalem. And the book of Acts tells us that he sat at the feet of the great Gamaliel. Today, when there are good professors, we call them Gamaliel. Gamaliel was one of the mentors of Paul. He was taught according to the perfect manner of the law. As a result, he lived after the most straightest set. And he was so brilliant as a scholar, and so ardent for the doctrines and traditions of Judaism, that he went beyond many of his peers in learning and zeal. He was a young man who was contented with the expression of the Filipinos, "Wadina." You know, we Filipinos, and probably even in other countries, when we manufacture our own product for Filipino use, we do not do it very well. But when it is for export, like the US and Canada and some other countries, wow! We do it well, very well, excellent. But if it is for the use of the Filipinos, we do it. We do not do it well. Sabi natin, okay na yan, pwede na yan. But that is not the case of Paul. As a young student, he was doing his very best in studying, in obeying the rules. Oh, he was not only determined to do it to the best of his ability, but he goes beyond his peers. In other words, probably we can consider him as the first, the best among the best. And according to tradition, he was short, stooped, and bow-legged. So you could imagine, short, stooped, and bow-legged. Though he was small, yet he was very bold. He was small, and yet he was very bold. And the book of Acts, chapter 9, verses 1 to 9, Acts 22, 4 to 11, and Acts 26, 9 to 18, it talks about the conversion of Paul. And we knew very well the story that he went to Damascus. He asked permission from the high priest. Probably the high priest knew, and you know, it was known to them that he was a zealous, you know, he was really a zealous man, on top of his peers as a young man, obeying the very strictest law of Judaism. And so, you know, he asked permission from the high priest to give him letter for him to arrest those Christians who are living in Damascus. And of course, nearing Damascus, saw that line, and he was struck. He fell down, and he was asked, Saul or Paul, what are you persecuting me? And he asked, who are you, Lord? In other words, he probably recognized that the voice is not coming from an ordinary person. That's why he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And the voice said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." And of course, we knew the story, that he was brought to the man, Judas, living in the street called Straight. And later on, you know, Judas, a man by the name of Judas, he was the person who took care of Paul. And Judas was living in the street called Straight. And later on, Ananias was sent to do what God commanded him to do. Now, as I reflect on this, I can see God told Ananias, because he was a friend, Ananias knew who Paul was, a very known figure in Judaism because of the persecution that he was doing, and so he was afraid. And God said, "Go, because I have chosen him." And later on in the book of Galatians, chapter 1, verses 15 and 16, Paul says, "I was set aside before I was born." How did he knew, or how did he know, that he was chosen by God before he was born? Basically, it was because of the personal encounter with God. Of course, we knew that as a Jews practicing Judaism, of course, basically, Paul has that desire to serve God, and so he thought that what he was doing is pleasing before God. And I would like to challenge you that one of the basic foundations to know whether we are called by God is if we have that desire to serve God. If I may ask you tonight, do you really have that desire to serve God? It's only you can answer that. Reflecting my experience, of course, I told you, I did not dream to become a pastor, never. I was born a Catholic. I grew up as a Catholic. I was converted when I was in 4th year high school. My elementary years in public, my high school days in public. But I remember trying to look back, trying to reflect. When I was young, aside from the rosary, I used to pray. I remember, of course, I tell God in my personal prayer, "God, I would like to give my life to you, and I would like to serve you." That was my prayer when I was young, before entering elementary years and during elementary years. Later on, when I was in high school, I became an altar boy. Became as a Christian. And there I wanted to become a priest. Unfortunately, it was not materialized. And later on, I was converted into Adventism. But of course, I did not dream to become a pastor. I planned to join the Philippine Marines. I was accepted, passing the written exam, but I fail when it comes to height. Unano. Then of course, I took accountancy. Outside, I took accountancy for 1 year. When I came to AUP, I continued taking accountancy. You know, I mentioned before to you, Dr. Cormay was taking ministry. Mr. Apalat was taking ministry. I was taking accountancy. But later on, you know, I don't know what happened. We were brought to different directions, and I became a pastor. They became accountants, and they are now there in the accountancy. But you know what Mr. Cormay said when we're talking about? He said, I was reflecting when I was a student. He wanted to become a pastor, but he said, when I tried to analyze the work of a pastor, it's very hard, and I cannot do it. So that was probably the reason why he changed. On my part, when I joined the Ministerial Association, and we started visiting people, praying for the sick, singing, teaching the children, I felt something, you know, that's why I said, probably I can become a pastor too. And that was the turning point in my life. Looking back, probably the Lord listened to my prayer when I was young, that I would like to serve Him. I would like to give my life and to serve Him. And of course, there was another challenge. You have heard this many times. But for the sake of encouraging you, every Friday afternoon, I used to go to that porch behind the president's office. Before we are allowed to go behind, there is no barrier there. There is no hindrance going to the other side. And every Friday afternoon, I talked to God. I said, God, this is my challenge to you. Because I am a sole supporting student and I do not have money, if you need me in the ministry, please send somebody to help me in my studies. And when I finish, I will serve you the rest of my life. To make a long story short, it did happen. And if I will tell you my story, oh, till morning, will not be able to finish it. But as I look back and as I reflect, I know that God has called me where I am now. Why? Because of my experience in the past. And when I challenged God, He answered my prayer. I had a personal encounter with God. And so, like Paul, my question is, did you have a personal encounter with God? That as you reflect, you can say, well, I know that God is really leading me towards this calling. Or you will say, oh, because, you know, from the education department, I was told to transfer to the College of Theology. Anyway, we may have different reasons, but the thing is, to me, that personal encounter of Paul with the Lord Jesus on the road to Damascus, he understood inwardly and outwardly that he was really called by God. And of course, I can see that Paul, you know, as a young man who had that desire to serve God, did his part to really prepare himself. Of course, it was confirmed by God. But even before he was called by God, he did his very best in preparing for serving the Lord. That's why I'm thinking, are you really, you know, today we have the outcome-based education. That will please tell me if it's enough. Huh? Kasi baka mapa. We have now the outcome-based education. It means that today, the Department of Education and the College of the Higher Education, the Commission on Higher Education, are not just letting educational institutions teach students, but they would like to see the skills. What are the skills for this degree? Therefore, when they graduate, they will be looking for that specific skills and concepts that they have learned in their profession. And so the board exams will be given matching the skills and the concepts that they have learned. In other words, the curriculum should match the need of the field, the industry. As I reflect on this, I said, probably we can do also the same with the ministerial students. That we will try to outline the specific skills that you will be needing as a pastor and the concepts that you have to understand and be able to explain and be able to discuss. And if you fail on those, probably we will not let you go. We will still enjoy being together for some time until you are able to explain and be able to really do and produce the skills that you need when you are out of this university. That's why I'm happy. You know, do not be angry with Pastor Conejas when he started trying to make things run. Some of you were, you know, not very happy with that. But you know, I said it's good that the 30 in AUP came. Not to discourage you, but to help you. And look at this. I will be presenting to you are coming from the IBMTE, International Board of Ministerial Theological Education of the Seventh-day Adventist. But before that, George Barna, one of the famous researchers who is very fond of doing research about churches in America, said, many pastors are so frustrated, unsatisfied, and overwhelmed by their work that they turn inward for strength rather than upward for God's guidance and power. His conclusion, those of us who conduct research on the spiritual lives of pastors have reason to wonder if, perhaps, greater attention needs to be placed on developing his closeness to God before he can exhort others to devote themselves following the Creator. Pastor Fernando talked last night about the preparation of the heart, which is very, very foundational and very, very important for ministerial students. The same research mentioned, I do not have time to present it here, but there were research conducted, and the Adventist members were asked, and they said, that the academic preparation of our ministers are a little bit okay. Not excellent. Okay, acceptable. But when it comes to their spiritual life, meaning their relationship to God, they are below the standard. And I remember the statement of one of the converts in the Adventist Church. He said, how I wish that you pastors, when we are in your presence, or you are close to us, we can feel the presence of God. And he said, referring to one of the leaders, said, I'm sorry to say this, but when I met him, he shook my hand. I did not feel that he is a pastor. I felt that he is a politician. So, essential qualities of Seventh-day Adventist minister. If you are planning to become a minister, these are the qualifications that you should have. This is from IBFDE. Okay, we're talking about this with Pastor Cuneo. So I said, I gave this to my pastoral students. I said, this will be your job description or qualities that you should learn. Seventh-day Adventist minister evidences the following personal qualities. Number one, an experience of conversion. Live out in a transformed and wholehearted following of Christ, a humble rejoicing in the forgiveness and love of God, and a life of obedience and witness through the Holy Scriptures. An experience of conversion. Have you experienced conversion in your life? You don't have to answer me, you don't have to raise your hand. But you know who you are. Because basically, if you have not experienced conversion, then there is a big question mark. If you are taking theology, because I have told my students that those who are students here of AUP before taking theology, but they are paungguyong-guylan, pawarte-warte. You know what? They are not taking it seriously. When they are out in the field, they do the same. And unfortunately, they are no longer in the ministry. If you are the product and we are the manufacturers, we need to make it sure that our product will really pass the standard. And I hope that through God's grace, we'll be able to make you, to train you, to really be somebody that when you go out in the field, you will make a difference in the life of these people. You know, I have a very big question mark in my mind. You ask people, churches built in 1950s, World War II, there were 35 members when it was established. You ask them how many members they have today. 35 or 40 after so many years. And I am challenging my pastoral ministry students. You know what? Pastor, a little bit jamming with the members, a little bit picnic, a little bit fellowship, a little bit eating there and there. And after 3 years, 5 years, you are transferred. But what is the impact that you have given to your church members? And basically, the work of the church, the board, is for the spiritual nourishment of the church members and also for mission. And if we stop doing our work, the work of Christ for mission, then we see we stop existing as a church. That is the only reason why we are here. Because of the mission. If we stop doing the mission, then we stop existing as a church. So today, try to go out. Enter. After 50 years of existence, how many members are left? When it was established, organized, 35 members. After 50 years, there are 40 members. Why? What is happening? What is happening? And basically, the life of the church, the direction of the church, is dependent on the leadership and pastors. Conversion. Number two, an Adventist identity grounded in a biblically informed worldview and centered in a clear biblically based understanding of the gospel of Jesus Christ In the framework of the story of the great controversy from Eden lost to Eden's son to be restored, such an identity will be evident in personal life, service, and mission. Probably no problem with that. Let's proceed. An active love for people, probably no problem with that. Emotional stability, no, not much problem. Okay. A sense of divine calling to gospel ministry, affirmed by the church and resulting in a passion to save the lost, which orient one's life with diligent service and mission in the context of the three angels' message. A sense of divine calling to gospel ministry. I know that there are future pastors here, ministers' wife. Although you are still sweethearts, may I see your hands? Those who are sweethearts of many young theologians, young ministers. Nobody? Oh, you have to question, you know. Oh, may I see your hands again? Do not be embarrassed. Good. Orbit. Oh, never mind. Anyway, you are included because of nose. Yeah. By the way, you young ladies, you should see to it that you are also called by God. Do not love only your sweetheart today because he is handsome or because intelligent or whatever, but because you would like to serve the Lord, you love your partner, and you love the world serving God. Amen?
Amen.
I know one. They got married. They worked in the field for some time. Then finally, the lady said, "I'm sorry, I cannot go with you anymore, because I do not like this kind of work." What a tragedy. He left the pastor husband, went somewhere else. I do not know what happened. The pastor, of course, also left the ministry, because in the Philippines, it's not okay that you are alone, left by your wife, and you are still in the ministry. So, my challenge to you is, if you really have that desire to serve God, you love serving God and serving people, so be it. That's why our advice to our young ministers, look around, scout for ladies who are really, you know, who are really have the desire to serve God. Okay? Because you will not have much problem later on. A little adjustment, because, you know, they love God, like you, they will be with you, they will be supporting you. Next! A Seventh-day Adventist minister is knowledgeable of and committed to God. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. No problem. God's Word. No problem. Okay. As the essential authoritative source of God in gospel teaching life ministry. No problem. The message and fellowship of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. No problem. Participation in God's redemptive mission. No problem. No problem. Right? I know that you do not have a problem there. Okay. Next. This is the thing that I would like you to think a little bit. A Seventh-day Adventist minister is skilled in studying and interpreting scripture in order to discern God's message. Studying and interpreting. Oh, these are the things now. The ideas, the concepts. These are now the systematic theology. Okay? The ideas, what we believe. I tell you, if you are a pastor and you cannot explain our beliefs, our doctrines, that's why I'm challenging some of my students. I said, you know, one of the doctrines that is a little bit hard for us to explain is the sanctuary. That's why I said, little by little, grasp the idea. Give lectures in the local churches so that you will be able to familiarize how it, you know, our explanations on this. Because you know what? If you are not able to explain it, probably we recommend someday that if you cannot explain our doctrines, then you should not be allowed to go. You have to stay with us so that you'll be able to share smiles from time to time. I took, you know, I told these young ladies, I said, okay, assignment. to research about the life of Daniel. I was teaching Daniel in Revelation. I told you this many times, right? Never mind with the sake of illustration. This is the problem with the pastor. Repeating illustrations. Good if the audience are different. But if the same, oh, they get tired of your illustration. And so, you know, one time submitted. Because I told them to search about the life of Daniel. And so, one student submitted while I was reading. And Daniel was so angry with the Germans that he encouraged his father to fight with the Germans. How in the world? Daniel is fighting with the Germans and so angry with the Germans. Pastor Cuneos, if you have students like this, please, for God's sake, let them think and try to find another line of work. Just kidding. Because I know that many of you will be doing your share. But seriously, if today you cannot explain that you are graduating, it's a tragedy. It's a tragedy. Imagine you are a pastor, you are graduating, and then you cannot explain our doctrine. I'm sorry to say this. Ay, mga spelling. Gagraduate na, mali-mali pa rin yung spelling. What kind of boy? I said, wow. Simple spelling? You cannot do it? I'm sorry to say this, but I would like to challenge you. With Paul, he prepared himself well. And he goes beyond with his peers. He was intellectually prepared. And of course, he was also converted. I would like to challenge you young people. Do not be comforted, you know, with the idea that it's alright, you know. And sometimes you are coming to teachers, huh? Oh, give me grade, you know, because I would like to graduate. And we discuss in this COT. We said, why is it that our, you know, they are not thinking of the training, but they would like to graduate very soon. And when you graduate very soon, wow, people in the field said, why is it that you graduate these students? They do not know, you know, they do not know what they're doing. And so they said, the problem is the AUP College of Theology. The teachers there are not good. They have to be changed. Because they are not manufacturing their product very well. And accidents will happen because of them. Young men, future pastors, you will be shaping the direction of the church. You will be guiding the work of God someday. And I would like to challenge you, prepare mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Like Paul. Next, imparting a thorough and practical understanding of the eternal gospel and the hope of salvation by preaching, teaching, healing, and discipling in a way that is grounded in biblical prophecy and expectation of the soon coming of Jesus Christ. This has something to do with our intellectual skills. This has something to do with our intellectual skills. And of course, I know. You know, Pacquiao wasn't able to undergo a formal training. He became very popular because he was a champion. He taught, what's this, for you to be able to graduate high school? The ARLS, Alternative Learning System, was able to pass. And of course, because he was popular, he has the courage to run for Congress. He won, he became a congressman. Because he was popular, he had the courage to run for the Senate. And he won. I tell you, you are much, much better than Pacquiao. But you know what? How did he do it? He had the courage and he had the determination to learn. And so, you know what he did? After winning the Congress, the seat in the Congress, oh, he hired people who are knowledgeable on the work, and he sat under them. Okay? And now he knows, of course, the pros and cons, the ins and outs of the process. He knows. And some people who are the lawyers cannot underestimate him, because of course he did not have the formal training, he did not have the formal education, he is not a lawyer, and yet he knows. Why? He had that desire to learn. Do you have that desire to learn? Or you say, Pastor, enough staying in the UP, I would like to go out now in court. Oh. And you know, I have learned that we have already people out there in the field working, but they still have incompletes and failing grades still at AUP, and they're working the field that people know that they're already graduate. But I tell you, they will have problems later on, because they will not be accepted. Learn and have the desire to learn. There is no, you know, no matter how a metal without you know, these dull metals like the these used for cars, you know, the moment you how do you call this? You put it with this carburando, you know, sandpaper, not sandpaper. You sharpen it, you know. Oh, after doing it for so many times, I promise you, it will be sharpened. And of course, discipling individuals into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ by nurturing, training, and mentoring. And as I used to say, you cannot be one you do not have. My dear students, my dear future pastors and leaders of the church, the Adventist church, I would like to challenge you that while you are here, take it seriously. Because very soon, you will be out in the field and you will be shaping the world of the church. I was so happy to learn. Our first graduates last year is Angolans, Marquez, Joao, Mola, and Vegas. They are now handling big churches in Angola. It means that they will apply now the things that they have learned here. But if they are things that the things that they have learned here are broken, negative, of course, those are the things that we'll be doing. And so we hope and pray for us as we train you to become better pastors, and pray for the Holy Spirit to give you inspiration, to give you determination, like hope, to do your best intellectually, and of course, to fully surrender and commit your life to God. Because I know that through you, God's work will be triumphant, will be victorious. I know that as pastors, you will be able to make a difference in the life of these members in the field. And someday when the Lord Jesus comes, all of us will be happy to live with Him in that eternal home. God bless us.